And welcome back, family, to another wonderful edutainment edition of The Artemis Presents We All Be News and Radio. I'm your host for the Empowerment Hour, Brother Ron, also known as R2, C2, H2, The Artemis. And you are welcoming back the We All Be Nation. Please feel free to join us in this very important discussion at area code 646-652-4553. Once again, you call in at area code 646-652-4593. If you're scared of going to err, we're about to open up the chat room. So if you got any comments or questions, you can feel free to post them in the chat room. And who knows, it might be read on the air. We got a couple of things going on. First and foremost, we got the most honorable Brother Dick Gregory on for the umpteenth time on We All Be Radio. And he's got a lot of interesting things to talk about. Today's show, of course, is Confessions of a Thought Provocateur, Brother Dick Gregory Live. But also we have some other important news to talk about as well, because it's so important right now that, you know, people realize that information is the true currency of the universe. Information is power. Like my brother Dick Gregory would say, our brother Dick Gregory, he said that good information is good power, and bad information is bad power, but it's power nonetheless. So we want to inform you all, please feel free to stand on ready with pen and paper handy. We got a lot of good information to give out to you all. And we got a special guest on as well, as you just recall. Before I get into it, the number that was played a couple of numbers ago was Brother Sean James with Sunshine. That's Brother Sean James out of sunny L.A., indie soul artist you need to check out, Sun Jane Sunshine. And also we played Tommy Edwards, It's All in the Game. And we are definitely playing a game of cat and mouse here in this world as we know it, with the truth and with facts. So we're going to dispel the myth and reveal the truth and do away with the lies on this radio show today. We all be. And without further ado, we also played a clip about, I don't know if you've been on a rock lately, past couple weeks, the Sister Maggie Rhodes. Sister Maggie Rhodes, her son, which we all call Baby Ashton, was horrifically mutilated by some doctors in Memphis at Christ Community Health Center. He was going in for, I guess, what they call a routine circumcision, but ended up with his penis being mutilated. And the other scary part to this whole tale was the fact that Sister Maggie was not informed of her son's horrific injury. As a matter of fact, the doctors sent him home, and the only reason she knew about what happened was because, as the story said, her sister went to look into his diaper. She saw a diaper or a cloth full of blood with no penis. So we're going to talk with Sister Maggie Rhodes and also her lawyer, Brother Sweet, about this story as well. So please feel free to sound once again if you want to get in this conversation. Area code 646-652-4593. And without further ado, I got the lawyer for Sister Maggie, Brother Sweet. Are you there?
I'm here.
Hey, welcome to the show, man. It's an honor to have you on. I guess we're waiting on for Sister Maggie to call. How you doing today?
I'm doing fine. I just recently talked to her. She's coming on. You know, she has her hands full now. She just had a daughter who had, she's having a tough time in her life. She had a daughter who had open heart surgery, and then she had this, and then her son had an infection set up, and she was unable to get help locally. So she had to leave her job at night, go to another hospital out of town to get him taken care of, Baby Ashton, before his infection is set up. So she's had
a
lot of time. Yeah.
So
it's not over. I mean, she is a young lady, single mom that's really struggling, and these doctors did this to her. Not only is it financially, she's been fired from two jobs because she has to leave to see about a kid, but can you imagine the emotional toll that you have to go through, that she's gone through? And she's really struggling. She's a nice person. She's a great little lady. And we're doing all we can do to help her hold up right now. We're pursuing this lawsuit, but she needs support right now, every day.
And speaking of that, and we got Sister Maggie. Go ahead, sir. I'm sorry.
No. She's on there? Maggie, you there?
Yes, she's on. We got Sister Maggie on air. How you doing, Sister Maggie?
Yeah.
Hello, how are you?
It's an honor to have you on. Like I said, like I told you, a lawyer and yourself, I did not hear about this story. Even though I live in Memphis, I know, and I hate to say it, I did not hear about this story until I was out of town in St. Louis. I'm in St. Louis right now, and a friend from D.C. called me and told me about this story, and I had to go online because I could hardly believe it. But this is very much real. You was covered by several local news shows, and I just want to get your point of view. What's going on right now? I know your lawyer filled us in on some of the things, but to get it from your point of view as well, we want to know what's going on with you. How you feeling right now?
Hey, Maggie, start with telling them about how Baby Ashton set up an infection and you had to leave town the other day to go get him help, and you had to leave your job and you were fired again because you had to leave. Start with that.
Yes. Well, Thursday I was at work and Ashton could hardly breathe, so I left work. I told them what was going on, and I also stated to them that he could hardly breathe, which he got an infection from his penis area. So I told my job that he could hardly breathe. So they told me that, okay, you can go home and see to Ashton. And so I got called back the next day saying that my job had ended.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I took him to the Obama Children's Hospital. They refused to give him a breathing treatment. They suctioned his nose, and they just sent him home. They didn't give him any medicine or anything. And so as we got back to the house, Ashton still continued not breathing, so I had to drive 2.5 hours to my hometown, which is Greenville, Mississippi, and take him to the doctor for special care.
Oh, wow.
And they prescribed him with breathing medicine, and they also gave him an antibiotic for the infection in his blood system.
This all set up for the penis, and this all set up from that situation. And he was life threatening the other night. She just had to, she had to leave her job, and the job called her back and said, your job's over. You can't come back because you had to leave. So now she has 2 kids, and she's just struggling. It's very difficult for that young lady.
Three
kids, I'm saying. I mean, but you had 2 that were really seriously. Your daughter just had a medical problem. Yes.
Open heart surgery.
So your daughter just had open heart surgery, and your son just got castrated.
October
the 15th.
Yes.
And your son just got castrated, but you're not able to get any type of treatment from Lamona Children's Hospital in the city where you live. You had to go all the way back to your hometown of Greenville to get your child seen, correct? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, sir.
And how far a drive is that?
2.5 hours for me.
So you basically had to go 2.5 hours to get your child seen by a doctor in a city that boasts about St. Jude, about Lebanon, and all this other stuff, but with no hospital in the city will see your child. That's what you're telling me.
Yes. And when I take Esther in for, like, pain in his penis area, they brush it off. They, like, skip over the fact that I brought him there for that. They don't do no examination. They don't do no x-rays. They don't even want to touch that part.
Oh, wow. I want to talk to you. Look, is this sounding legal? What they doing to her? Like, does she have rights in this matter? Is it related to her employment? Like, could they fire her for these type of things?
Well, it's employment in real state. So, we pass all these laws and give these southern states the right. They want to attract business. So they have this employment in real states. And unless you're a member of a union or you have a federal constitutional right, they can just terminate you. Yeah. When the legislatures pass these what they call right-to-work laws or employment at will, it allows them to do these type things. Yes. And that's what's happened. So, we'll pursue it, but as far as our workers' rights, Tennessee is one of these right-to-work places where, they can just terminate you for anything they want.
Oh, wow. And this, the thing about it is, we got the story about Baby Ashton, but I didn't even know about what was going on with your daughter until we talked earlier today on the phone and talking to your lawyer. We don't know this now that basically you have been blackballed by the medical establishment, it sounds like, in Memphis, and you have not been allowed to make a living to support your two kids who are very sick, as well as three kids overall. So this is a story we're not getting on the media.
Yeah. And I didn't want to direct her. I want her to tell you about her experience at the hospital. But I want people, that is so outrageous what they did. But the treatment that she continues to get is outrageous. And I just want people to know that they did her child like this, and, you know, she's trying to make it by herself. And here's the treatment she continues to get. Now, I want her to relate to you what happened at the hospital, but I want you to understand what she continues to go through on a daily basis right now, right? But, Maggie, tell them about what happened when you took your son in.
Sir, could you repeat that?
Tell them about what happened. You went in for just a routine procedure. Tell them what happened.
Yes, I went in. They told me that. She asked me to step out the room. The procedure would take 20 minutes. And when I went in the hallway. She told me I could stand right by the door. And I went in the hallway, and my baby was in the operation room and inside the clinic and on the table. And I felt like they didn't give him any pain medicine. He screamed the whole time they had him in the room. The procedure took 3 hours instead of 20 minutes. And me and my friend Gabriel Henderson, we kept knocking on the door, asking what's going on with my baby. Any questions? So she brought the baby back out the room. She was still screaming. And she gave us the baby and said everything went great. And when I made it to my home, my sister noticed that my baby was still screaming. She went in there and she pulled back the bandage and noticed that the penis was gone. After she told me don't remove the bandage for 4 to 5 days.
Oh, wow.
Don't remove the bandage for 4 to 5 days.
4 or 5 days, but he'd be bleeding to death. It sounded like he was bleeding profusely, right? He was just bleeding.
Yes, and when I went up to the doctor's office to confront the doctor the next day, and with the my tape recorder, she was like, "It wasn't a cover up. They made an honest mistake on my baby," and she kept saying that it wasn't a cover up. And I'm like, "You didn't even tell me inside the clinic," and she was like, "Well, he was losing so much blood." And I'm like, I didn't know anything. You gave me back my son and told me everything went well.
Oh, my God. In four or five days, they think it'd be better?
Well, in 4 or 5 days, they could argue several things happen. They could say, let me finish, Maggie. Legally, they could say, oh, he's been gone 4 or 5 days. We can't say what happened in 4 or 5 days. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So
they didn't
want her to open it immediately. They want her to come back, and they said, well, we don't know what happened. When we left, everything was fine. You see what I'm saying?
But he might be dead. I mean, he would be dead if he's bleeding, right? I mean, would he be dead in 4 or 5 days if he didn't get immediate medical attention?
His pamper was covered in blood. Like, it looked like the blood was soaking through the pamper.
Wow.
You see what I'm saying, though? If you leave... Well, if she had left and she had not come back for 4 or 5 days, and either he died or something happened, they would be able to argue, well, he must have been fine for 4 or 5 days. You didn't come back. You see what I'm saying? So they asked not to open the pamper for that period of time. That gives time to pass, and for them to argue, it wasn't them. But she checked it immediately. You understand what I'm saying? If you leave the hospital and this happens, huh?
We listening?
Yeah, if you leave the hospital and then this has happened and then you don't check it for 4 or 5 days and then you come back and say, look what happened, they'd be arguing it was her or it was some other circumstance, it wasn't them. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So by her checking immediately and not waiting 4 or 5 days, it probably saved her son's life and it directed the attention directly to them. And she went in and confronted them. And her friend had a phone recorder on, and we had the conversation recorded.
All right, good. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah.
I'm glad to hear you got that on tape. So we're gonna take a quick break to come back. We're going to bring in our guest, Dick Gregory, and hopefully inform him about what's going on with Sister Maggie and Baby Ashton and see what we all can do to get involved and help get this case more attention and also to help get some justice, because this is atrocious. We'll be right back on We All Be Radio. And that was Brothers Keepers with Ghetto Tears. And this is Brother Ron, RQC2H2, the artist, with We All Be, with our special guest, Sister Maggie Rhodes, and Brother Sweet, her lawyer, representing the strange case of Brother Ashton, Baby Ashton, who was castrated by Christ Community Health Center on Broad Avenue in Memphis, Tennessee, against the wishes of the mom. Sister Maggie, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, so I'm going to ask you this, and Brother Sweet as well. What has been the support? I mean, has there been any people coming to you after seeing the news story? Have you got any organizations involved with this story? Because I'm familiar with Intact Memphis, I believe. You had a protest in front of Christ Community Health Center this past Friday. But what has been, like, the feedback from this story?
I wasn't aware of the protest that went on at Christ Community because I was in Greenville, Mississippi on this Friday with my son, Ashton Rhodes, at the Regional Medical Center.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't hear about the story until after I made it back to Memphis.
Right. She hadn't got much feedback. But she's been she had a job working from 11 to 9 to 7 in the morning trying to support her and her kids. And so she was sleeping. I mean, it's been very difficult. We talk, but she's been working, and then this emergency came up. And I think, Maggie, you went a couple of days without any sleep driving him back to Greenville. So she's not... It's not been that she hadn't been appreciative of what everybody's trying to do, but you got a young lady that's been stuck in a struggle with her kids and this castration of her child, and it's been very difficult for her by herself.
But what about I always say this. I always got to ask these questions when it comes to cases like this. I mean, even though this is like a very rare and unfortunate case, like, what about the NAACP? Anybody from the NAACP reached out to you all concerning this matter?
No, they haven't. They haven't said anything to me about anything. When I was in the clinic on that day, they was that the one of the owners, Dr. Diego of that clinic, told me that whatever me and my son Ashton need, don't hesitate to ask. But he haven't reached out to us on any.
No, in fact. In fact, it's just been the opposite, Maggie. They had scheduled her to come back in October to examine him, talking about a potential reconstruction or something. And, Maggie, didn't they tell you it was in the notes or something that couldn't help you because of a potential lawsuit? And she hadn't even hired a lawyer at that time.
Yes. Dr. William, the urologist for Lavana Children's Hospital, he came in the room right after that. The procedure happened to my son, Ashton. I took Ashton that night to LaBarna Children's Hospital. Dr. Williams stated to me that it was a mix-up. And he said that they was going to do the surgery October the 17th, which my daughter had her open heart surgery October the 16th. We took Ashton over to Dr. Williams' office. I guess due to the lawsuit, he postponed the surgery for late April.
And she had not hired an attorney at that point or even noticed them of a lawsuit. They just said because of a potential lawsuit, they postponed it.
So this is where it comes from. In the news story, I know they said you had to get it postponed until sometime early next year. So this is the story behind that story, about the postponement.
That's the story behind it. Yes. And just to let you know, she's been depending on her family and to the extent anything I can do, but no one's really stepped out to help her. The news channels did the news story. They've been interested, but you all are probably one of the first ones to really step up to try and bring a national light on this for her.
Yeah, because this happened back in August, right, the surgery, if I'm not mistaken. It was in August, the circumcision. opposed to circumcision.
5/13, they took the report the day after, the next day. Ashton's legs was real swollen. They took the report the next day for me. When I left the doctor's office, I went straight over to Fox 13 News, and they had the story since August. And they didn't air the story until Channel 5 aired their story.
So you mean to tell me that they did this story back in August, or they're going to wait till somebody else? So you mean the news did this back in August, right? They covered the story back in August, what you saying?
Yes. On Fox 13, that was me in August. And when Channel 5 aired their story this month, that's when Fox 13 fell forward and aired their story.
So that's another story behind the story. I thought it was strange that we would hear about this story in November or whatnot, or October, when this event happened in August. So it sounds like it sounds like to me that there's some type of weird conspiracy going on, some collusion going on with the local media as well as the medical establishment. Like they're really trying not to make sure this story gets any type of traction.
Well, to be fair to the local media, Ron, mm-hmm. they basically said there was no lawsuit or anything at that point in time. They weren't privileged to the medical records. They only had one point of view, and they said they really need to investigate more. As it has come out, since she hired an attorney and other things have happened, it's starting to get more attention. But at that point, they were saying they could only get one point of view, to be fair to them. So,
okay.
That's what they said, you know. And you know, of course, the clinic will not talk. You should call them and ask them their position. Ask them, you know, you need to call them and ask them, why haven't you stepped up to help this young lady? Why could this kid set up an infection and I don't step up to help him? Why she got to leave her job and drive 2 hours at night? She's been up for 2 days with a child trying to go get medical help. Why aren't y'all helping her? You can ask them that question. I mean, everybody wants to make it legal, and then they want to get on this, but they can step up and help her. She's been back to Lobana.
She deserves an answer. Man, my God, they cut off her son's penis. They cut off his penis.
Well,
I mean, why are they trying to hide behind HIPAA law?
Well, you understand. You know, we got all these laws now to protect the doctors and protect all this stuff. You know, all the legislation's passed, all that stuff. And it's really class-based. Mm-hmm. So when they do something to a poor person, a young lady who's young, with children, working a regular job, they have all kind of laws to protect them and hide behind. And they're using that to their advantage at this point. That stuff needs to be examined. What's happening to her is outrageous. And what is happening to her every day? She has a tough life right now. We talk. Mm-hmm. I get calls from her the other night. She called me. She said, I'm a lawyer. I'm not a doctor. With tears in her eyes, I said, Mr. Sweet, my son has an infection. I've been in the hospital. What can I do? And I had to tell her, get on the road. Go to another hospital. You got to go do it. She has to walk away from her job where she has to provide for her other kids, but she had to do it. You know, Ron, I want you to think about that choice. I'm going to walk away from my job, and these people are going to fire me, that I got to take care of me and my children, or I got a son who's set up an infection who may die. I got to go get him help. What kind of choice is that for a young lady to have to make? You know what I mean?
Yes, Sister Maggie, I mean, I hear what Brother Sweet is saying, and it's like, I know I read the article with the news stories, and it's like you said, like, you feel like you failed your son, but I don't really think you failed your son. I just think that the society has failed you all. People have failed you all. People are hiding behind their positions, their degrees, their whatever, but they're not trying to say, you know what, we messed up. They're not trying to own up to it, but they want to make you pay for what they did wrong. And it's not right. And
I agree.
I was talking to you, Brother Sweet. I can't imagine how it would be to be Baby Ashton. I can't imagine how you would feel growing up and, you know, the damage that have been done that we can't really comprehend at this moment. But the fact that they're making it worse by trying to cover up this crime, because it sounds like it's a crime to me. I mean, I know it might have been a quote-unquote accident at first, but the cover-up seems like, you know, it's hard to say this, but the cover-up sounds like it's worse than a crime, even though it's horrific what they did. But
well, you know,
what about the church then? Go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. No, you're asking important questions.
I don't know about the church. I mean, we got a lot of church here. It's like, Sister Maggie, you a woman of faith. What has been the church's response? Anybody from the church community?
Well, my pastor, he been real supportive of me and my family. He really stepped up when my little girl went and had her upper heart surgery. He was there during the whole time. And I would like to just thank my church.
And let me say this to you.
Her
pastor. Say it again, Maggie. I was going to run.
Sir?
And Ron, her pastor tried to bring. Say your pastor's name again, Maggie.
Calvin Jones.
And your church, what's your church home?
Prayer and Deliverance.
Okay, well, go ahead.
Her pastor has been out here trying to bring attention. He tell me, he talked to CNN. He was trying to get attention brought to it.
Yes, he has talked to CNN. He tried to contact them to get my story aired on CNN and other places. He did talk to his friends in California about this and several other places.
Yeah. We have to give her pastor credit. He has really tried to step up. But, Ron, a lot of organizations now that we had before to go to aren't as receptive right off the bat as they were in the past, I would say.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right. What about a National Action Network with Al Sharpton? Have y'all reached out to any of his people?
I have not. I had a case where a young man was shot in the back of the head up in Delta, not far from where Maggie's from. I called him about that, and it's very receptive. Those organizations have not seemed to be as receptive to individual cases to me. I mean, they have not. But I'll make another attempt tomorrow to call those organizations. You've been the most receptive.
See, that's the problem. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, you've been most receptive.
Yeah, but the problem is, being that these folks, the problem is that a lot of our organizations that we call black organizations are, like Sister Shahrazad Ali said, are begging organizations. They beg. They're too dependent on white people's charity. Like, you know, people say, I get involved with this case. You know, I'm going against the system. I'm going against this medical establishment. We probably got all types of backers and sponsors in corporate America. So if I take them on, I might lose my sponsorship for my thing. And it's like right now we're the self-pronoun generation. It's not what's in it for us, it's what's in it for me. But I tell you this, it's like what Haile Selassie told the League of Nations back in the 30s when Ethiopia was invaded by Italy. He said, today us, tomorrow you. So what's going to happen when the next Baby Ashton tragedy happens? Like, if somebody else experienced the same thing that Sister Maggie and her family experienced, what's going to happen to that person? How can people live with themselves knowing that a child was hurt by people we're supposed to be trusting?
Ron,
she said,
we're getting attention.
The doctor stated to me that she sat up all night wondering if she made a mistake on my son, and that's also on the tape recording.
So the doctor was a woman that performed the surgery?
Yes. She was like a Chinese lady. Her name was Dr. Liu. And she stated to me that she stayed up all night wondering if she made a mistake on my son, Ashton.
But there was more than her
all night wondering. Did she wonder? Wait, I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, there was another. What was the other doctor's name?
She injured him, right? Mm-hmm.
There was another doctor involved. What's his name, Megan?
Dr. Diego.
So, yes, Dr. Liu was the lead and Dr. Diego?
No, Dr. Diego was the lead doctor of the clinic, and Dr. Liu was just a doctor working in the clinic.
But she didn't want to actually try to perform she did a castration. She didn't want to get the castration.
Yes, and she stated to me that she made an honest mistake on Ashton, and she went home and sat up all night wondering if she made a mistake on Ashton or not.
Okay, she say all that. My thing is, like, it's like when a person gets caught for a crime. You're not sorry that you commit the crime. You're sorry that you got caught. And for her to say that sounds to me disingenuous, because why do you send him home with a diaper full of blood and him bleeding profusely and him crying incessantly? Why would she
wait
say what she told you and then do something like that? Go ahead, I'm sorry.
And Ron, telling you not to open it up for 4 or 5 days.
Yeah, what is the conscience? Exactly. That don't sound right to me. That is very disturbing. I'm just surprised that more people are not outraged, but I'm glad that the intact Memphis people, see, there are people out there, but we just got to get this information out there and let people know what's going on. That's why the internet is so important, because it's really the sixth estate where you get more information out there that's unfiltered. But I believe that by you all being on this show today is going to open up a lot of doors. And I just want to keep on saying, y'all need to stay strong and hold on to keep the faith. And it's easy for me to say that, but I just want to know that she's not alone, because people are very much concerned. But the problem is, people want to know how to can they help. What would be the best way to help you all in this situation right now? You said that she's struggling financially. She lost her second job due to this case. What can we do? I mean, is there a website?
Okay.
What can we do? Let us know what we can do.
Here's two things you can do. The first thing is you and everybody on your radio program pray and send out a prayer for Maggie, Baby Ashton, and her family. And she has God in her life, and I think he'll help, but he needs to hear from all of you all how we all want to help her. So I would ask that everybody do that. The second thing, if anybody, it's tight times and it's hard, but if you have anything spare, any kind of cash spare, anything extra, would you please consider sending it to Maggie and Baby Ashton and her family. Anything you could give, $1, $2, to help her make it through this time would be very appreciated. She's lost her second job. She was behind on her rent. She's behind on a car note. She's got to have a car to get to the hospital and whatever. And if you ever wanted to give to something that's going to make a difference to somebody who deserves it, y'all could do that for her. So those are the two things I would ask.
So how can we do that? How we get the money out? Is it PayPal? What, got a P.O. box? What do we need to do to get the money out?
I tell you what I'll do. I will text you tomorrow with a PayPal and a number for her. We have not set it up.
But
I will tomorrow, and I'll get it to you. And if you can get it out, and we'll put it on your website, and then I'll put it on my website. Let me give you my website. My name is Dennis. It's dennis.sweets@ symbol sweetandassociates.net. Maggie, tell him I will not keep it down, will I, Maggie? I will make sure she gets every dime. And I'll send you Ron. I will send you a PayPal and everything tomorrow. I'll set it up so we can help
her. That sounds great. And also I want to ask Sister Maggie, I know you're a friend of the family, so this is personal for you as well, Brother Sweet. That's why you're helping Sister Maggie. But I don't know, Sister Maggie, was it hard for you to find any lawyers that were willing to look at the case in Memphis?
I never did look at...
Hello?
Sister Maggie?
Hello?
Hello? Yes.
Yeah, you kind of went out for a minute, Maggie.
I didn't even stop in Memphis on this. I went right to Jackson, Mississippi, that following week to Dennis Sweet office.
Yeah.
Okay. That's
well, her uncle,
somebody to trust.
Her uncle is a real community organizer. He has been very active in their community of Metcalf. It's a very poor community, and his name is Wayne Rhodes. And when I say he has done many things up in that community, political, raising money, holding office, and even getting baseball teams and other things together, he's been a real community organizer. So that's how I know Maggie, and that's how I know him. And he wanted me to do it. So she didn't look anywhere else. She listened to her uncle and came to me.
Well, I'm glad it's good. You know, in times like this, it's good to depend on folks that we consider family. I mean, she entrusted her son's life with a doctor that's supposed to be a person that's supposed to not do any harm on purpose, right? They got the Hippocratic Oath, not do any harm on purpose, all this stuff, and yet they would send her son home with a diaper full of blood And she, the doctor has the nerve to say she was thinking about this all night. But yet, you know, a surgery that wouldn't take that long, took 3 hours, did not even inform the mother of what was going on. And
to tell her not to take the diaper off for 4 or 5 days?
It's hard to believe.
So that when she, hoping when she discovers it, you could argue it was something, it was your fault or something else. That's the only reason you would say wait 4 or 5 days.
Right.
So when she discovered it, when she came back, they would say, it's your fault. You must have done something. We're going to report you to DHS for abusing your child. That's the only reason you would have them do it for 4 or 5 days, right?
Mm-hmm.
What other reason would you have them not undo the dressing for 4 or 5 days? What would be the purpose
of that? That's crazy. That's insanity. But I want to get to the phone lines. I think people want to ask you questions. I know Brother Dick Gregory, he's running late, but hopefully we get him in before we let you go. Get his take on what he can do to help. But I want to go to area code 917 on the air. What can we all be? That's there now. Your computer, you want to speak, sir? Or what? 917?
Every county in Florida, every day.
I just did this man for right now. We'll go to Chicago 773 on the air. What can we all be? You have anything to say to our guests?
Yes, hello, hi. How you doing, hi. Brother Vaughn? This is Major Christopher Vaughn. How are you doing?
Hey, Brother Major Christopher Vaughn. How you doing, man? You doing all right?
I'm doing great, and I was listening. I'm actually in Texas at Fort Hood now, but I was listening to your interview, and my heart goes out to Baby Ashton and to you, ma'am, and also to Attorney. Just wanted to express how sorry that I am that the system has failed you and that these things happen. But I wanted to, just for the brevity of time, I wanted to chime in and throw some things out there because I've dealt with the system, and I just wanted to give maybe some things that that could be done as well to donate some money as well. I wanted to ask, I'm a physician assistant and civilian. After the botched surgical procedure occurred, was there any follow-up with another doctor, another provider that was able to examine the procedure after the fact, post-surgery? And then second, has anybody, did you get actual discharge notes from the doctor?
Okay, was another procedure. Yeah, go ahead, Max.
Actually, after I left the clinic that night, I took him straight to the Burns Hospital because his legs had swelled up so big. And they had 20 or 30 doctors that came from all over the hospital in that room that day we was in the room. Every doctor that came in there said that, oh, wow, like, holy, you know, like, they made a mistake on my baby. And they were saying that to me when they called down the urologist. She was like, whoa. You know, his reaction was like, whoa. And that's when he shot up the surgery. Date was supposed to be on October the 17th, but due to the lawsuit, they postponed it.
And let me tell you, they haven't been in a lawsuit yet. But, yes, we requested all medical records from her ER visit.
Yes, sir.
And recently we got it's no problem. We just got the request sent back then. We had to prepay for them. So we, last week, sent a check back to them. We got the HIPAA form, and we made the request as I usually do. We got an unusual request that the records be paid for before we get them. So I sent the check in for what they requested. So we should be able to get them pretty soon. But we did get a HIPAA release. We did Maggie had the records from the procedure, but she does not have the ER records. And our experts needed those. So we made the request, as we usually do. We got the records. We got the note back from Labana that we had to pay for all the records before they were given to us.
Okay. That's common procedure in the hospital or the clinic, that they make you prepay before they actually give you the records.
Not every hospital.
No, you're absolutely right, and you kind of, because I've dealt with the malpractice aspect and physicians, when there is a lawsuit, and then they're going to basically sequester the individuals to come in for questioning. But the other thing I wanted to say real quick is...
But there's no lawsuit. she should be able to just get her records.
Right. No. I mean, I understand that. That's correct. What I'm talking about is in terms
do,
of...
Do you understand? Let me say, do you understand the state of the law, all these laws that have been passed? Now you have to get a doctor to give you an opinion that is negligence, even if it's obvious. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that doctor, no doctor will give you that opinion until you have all the records. So
correct.
We have sent them the procedure records, but he wants all of the records. So we had Maggie do a HIPAA and request the records. And now, just for her to get her the medical records, she has to pay for them ahead of time. Now,
okay.
You may say that's normal. I hadn't found it to be normal, but, you know, it's no problem. We pay for them. But it's the
right.
Right.
Well, it's a facility that I work at. Before they will release them, you sign the HIPAA, and then you do have to pay for them before they actually make the copies and then turn those over to you. And I understand that's not the same in every facility. But the other reason that I was
May I say this to you?
Yes, sir.
I think that's an outrageous procedure. And let me tell you why.
It is.
In this case, she has a lawyer, so I can pay for them. If
yes,
she
sir.
Just wants her records as a citizen and she's struggling financially, you mean to tell me she can go in and get her child's records? She got to come up with money?
Well,
she'll be denied her child's records. That's an outrageous
thing. Well, she shouldn't be. Usually the hospital, if you have hardships, they usually have a paperwork that you fill out, and they can give you those under hardship. But usually, probably in this case, they're trying to put all kind of roadblocks, I guess I really believe, to keep you from going forward.
We're talking about health care. How much does it cost to take the records, put them on a copy machine, and make a copy of them?
The
ER records. It may be 30.
Right.
It may be 30 pages. So how
right.
much does it cost them to do that? It's not, if they were to give this young lady her records without paying for them, it wouldn't be some big financial hardship to the hospital. Probably cost them $3.
I totally agree with you. The only thing I was going to say, because I've dealt with the system where I've spent over $100,000. Defending myself for something that was wrongfully happened. What I was going to say in terms of attempting to raise money, because I want to donate money and I want to be able to tell my friends and colleagues to also donate money, because I can understand her hardship in terms of her what she had to lose through her job and in terms of her trying to still keep her family and do all the things that she needs to do. I switched from the PayPal to the GoFundMe.com because it seems to be more clear, and I was just going to put that out there that you may want to consider that, because it's a easier process that I think than PayPal.
Okay, I want to
make some money once you give your information to Brother Ron and make sure that, you know, we do some donations and also some advocacy, because I'm in Chicago, but I could still do some things in terms of trying to advocate the case of the, you know, malpractice and the everything that was done maliciously and the misconduct that was that occurred with these medical providers.
Yeah, well, and I don't want to just take over. I want to say I appreciate it. It's very kind of you, and you do seem very knowledgeable. And the issue about prepay, I understand. But to me, you know, all these issues that she's facing kind of get to me a little bit, you know, even getting down to the point of getting her medical records, you know what I mean?
And the only thing I'm telling you is that you're absolutely on point. But the bottom line is that the facility is aware that there was a mistake made. Then we both know they're not going to own up to it. And I know you mentioned some of the other organizations, the NAACP, National Action Network, Rainbow Push. I live in Chicago. I went to Rainbow Push and gave them my documentation. I was a card-carrying member of all these organizations, and I've heard this in the past where they've said that these organizations, unfortunately, they're like toothless tigers. They're not what they used to be, and only at the grassroots levels and programs and stations like this, I think a lot of these unseen cases that don't really get the media attention that a lot of other cases do, that they really help the cause. So I was just simply saying, those things, I understand about the clinical nature, and I understand what the clinic is trying to do. They're trying to stave off what they are perceiving, even though there's not a lawsuit now. They know one is probably coming. So they're not going to be advantageous to try to help you. They're trying to cover their own, and they're not going to admit any guilt. So I'm about, in terms of how I can help, is rallying the folks that I know to get you some money as quick as possible. I mean, I'm just from me talking to people, I've raised a couple hundred, I've raised at least $200 already. So I just want to help. That's why I'm calling in, and I'm encouraging others to do it. But I just want to have a streamlined way to get the money to her.
Okay. I'll do both of them. Ron?
Yeah, we are. Thank you, Brother Chris. I appreciate it. And we also, yeah, we need to get organized and try to figure out ways to get this stuff done, not only with the information dissemination, but also try to get Sister Maggie some funds to support what she's going through right now. Because this is very important, man, because we're at war. And the thing about it is, like, we are at war. You know, you look at white people, especially in football and sports, they compare it to warfare. Everything white people do is war. Business is warfare. Culture is warfare. Education is warfare. Healthcare is warfare. And a lot of us are catching hell right now because we're not realizing that this is a war, war for resources, war for a lot of different things. But we got to get ready. We got to get organized because it seems like, unfortunately, it's going to get worse before it gets better. But we got to help each other back. So I thank Brother Chris for that as well. And we'll get another call. There's people waiting to call. Area code 212, you on the air? Welcome.
Thank you very much. Yeah, this
thank
is
you.
In New York. Yes. I want to ask a question. Did you have any reports of this situation happening and that with any of our children in this particular hospital? The reason why I ask is that I listened to Pacifica Station, WBAI here in New York City, and over the years we've heard about a number of cases like this, not only with black children, but with Jewish children especially, where the machine they used, the person operating it, obviously didn't know what they were doing, and they would mutilate the penis or take it off entirely. Or if you have, they have had children that were born with both the sex organs, both male and female, and they would accidentally take one off, and they said it was accidentally, and the, you know, parent had to decide how to raise the child. But in the case the child was white or Jewish, the hospital would cover themselves so that the parents couldn't sue them. And there's been a move in this country led by mainly Jewish nurses to try to put an end to the practice of circumcision. So I want to know if this has happened to other children, and was the decision the young ladies make to have the child circumcised, or did they convince to do that, or it was just a tradition in the family to do that, or what was the situation?
So what's your name, sir?
Ray from New York City.
Great for doing. Thank you for a great question. Sister Baggins?
Yes, I'm here.
There, you asking some of his questions?
I got my son circumcised because they were saying that, you know, when I was growing up, that was the right thing to do, was prevent from having infections, AIDS, and different bacteria. So I got him circumcised for that reason.
Okay. No, I understand that people tell you that. And by the way, I'm not circumcised, and neither are my brothers and most of my friends, and you don't get AIDS or infections if you're taught how to clean yourself properly, and you don't get AIDS just by not being circumcised. I mean, human males have the foreskins ever since there have been human males on the planet, and the majority of human males aren't circumcised. So that's just nonsense people told you, and they just passed that nonsense over to you, unfortunately. But the other question, has this happened to any other children in the hospital? Are you aware of?
We don't know that yet. We'll get that during discovery. We'll find out. Fortunately for the public, this was being brought to the forefront. People like Ron are bringing this out. But we don't know if things have happened to children that, I mean, for instance, they told her not to open the bandage for 4 or 5 days.
Mm-hmm.
If she had done that, if she had gone back to the hospital, they would have said, something you did, or you mutilated your child, right? If we did it, you'd have brought him right back. So we don't know if people have been intimidated not to speak up or whatever. We'll find out, though.
Because I have a very good feeling, very strong feeling, when you do your discovery, you're going to find out there's been other people in that town, in that state that has happened to, and you're probably going to find that it hasn't happened only to black children as well. It's happened to white ones as well. Would the brother call by any reason? They're requiring to pay for copies. the hospital, you're right, the hospital could provide that free. It doesn't cost, it's only cost pennies, really. But they're doing that to protect themselves and to put a roadblock in the way. That kind of nonsense happens here in New York City as well.
Right. What I'm saying to you is, you have a child that obviously you have injured. And you have a HIPAA request and a request from the mother and people who are concerned about it for records. And, of course, I've run into this before. I don't know what to pay until I send them the request. But, of course, I sent the request, and this is the response I got. In a case with this atrocious, you would think that even Labana, we're not even talking about. Maggie has the records from the clinic. It's Labana we need the records from. And, you know, they followed this procedure.
Right. Well, as I said,
and we're exploring the,
right,
the connection. I do believe there's a connection between Labana and the clinic, whether Labana owns it.
Look, sir,
yeah,
I'm
no, whether they own it or...
Yeah, no, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I'm saying here in New York, we had a place, we have a lot of hospitals in New York, and they were giving out what you would call no-bid contract. And we have a number of hospitals on the east side of in Manhattan, this east side and west side, and they were called Bedpan Alley. And on the east side, those were the hospitals that would get the bids from the city, no-bid contracts. So there is a lot of collusion within the medical industry in each city. So
that's right.
That's what you run into. So that's commonplace. Unfortunately, in every city, in every state, you're going to have that.
Well, and let me say this to you, and you're very right. You're very informative, and I don't ever want to detract. We're gonna explore all that. We're gonna explore it during discovery, and that legal process takes some time. The claim is for her son, but this young lady has to make it through this process financially, and. You know, as I said, she's been fired twice since this happened because she's had to leave her job to go see about her children. So please don't forget in this process about us, about the law and legal, the struggle that she has today. I really want to emphasize that. And everybody listen, I'm going to set this PayPal up. If y'all can help her, please do. Please help her. This is a young lady who is a great young lady. Her family has been in the community in Greenville and other places. They've contributed to the community. Her uncle's been an organizer, and she's at a point where she needs the community to turn around and give her a hand. All right?
If you contact, I'm not how you do it, but you contact WBI in New York and speak with Sheldon Walden, because he's done shows like this dealing with circumcision in New York on WBI. I'm not saying for sure, I'm just saying he's done shows like this. He might possibly be interested in it if you speak with Brother Leroy in New York.
I gave you my email. Did you get it? Dennis.Sweet@sweetandassociates.net.
Right.
If you would email me that, I will make the contact.
Do you have a phone number?
Yes. My number is 601-750.
Wait a minute, 601-750-0510. Okay, I'm writing it down.
750-0510. That's my cell, and I won't answer it.
0510.
And any information that you give me and any of these suggestions you have, I will do it for her. I'm going to take the time. That's what I'm going to do for her.
Okay, 0510. Okay, well, I'll just tell you the two people to contact, because Brother Lever, he does the show earlier today in New York, and Sheldon Walden, you have to contact him at BAI, and perhaps he might do a show. I'm not saying for sure, I'm just saying possibly. Because
yeah.
I don't know.
I'm not his producer
or anything like that. I just know that he's done shows dealing with circumcision before.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to thank Ron for contacting us and hearing about this and wanting to bring a light to it. And I will contact those shows. And then I'm gonna fall and depend on Ron some, because he's really stepped up for this young lady. And we really appreciate it, Ron. And I will make those other contacts, though.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, that's
good. Hey, Brother Leroy is a good brother. He actually emailed me today. But I talked to Brother Leroy. He's a good brother to be in touch with, and he got a huge listening audience up there in New York, up in Harlem and beyond that. So I want to thank the Brother Ray from New York to call in with that great information as well. But I think, while I'm listening to what Brother Ray was saying and what y'all talking about, discovery, and just listening to what Sister Maggie is going through, I would believe that you will find more cases like her because of what they're doing to her. Like, they're basically shutting her out of the system. They're making it hard for her to get a grievance hurt. I'm sure she ain't the first person they did this to. Like, not being able to get decent health care access within the vicinity of where she lives for her children, losing her job.
That's
how they work. And they go ahead. Mm-hmm.
No, Ron, you know, I think he was bringing out, the brother from New York was bringing out about Jewish kids and whatever. And I do think it's class. I think it's race and class. You know, that's the same thing Martin Luther King said when he came in for the, the sanitary workers' riot. I mean, march, not riot, in Memphis. He was saying it's not all about, you know. So I think this is the same thing, the same issue. It's race and class. I do.
I think it's something about, but then what is the necessity of a circumcision in this day and age? Like the brother said, you know, him and his brother are not circumcised. They're doing just fine, but most of the world isn't circumcised. And I know they're making such a big deal about females getting, their genitalia getting ruined in places like in Africa or other places, but there's no outcry for young boys to have their genitals mutilated. It should be an equal outcry, it seems. And with this case with Baby Ashton, unfortunately for him, but maybe this will make it better for other babies coming after him and people will get a wake-up call because the fact that Intact Memphis will respond the way they do or did, excuse me, on Friday, shows that there are people out there who can empathize and have compassion for what Brother Ashton and Sister Maggie is going through right now. But the only way, we just need to find a way to connect because, like she said, she didn't know about the protest until she was coming back into Memphis. And I believe they interviewed your great-grandmother, correct? Was it your great-grandmother they interviewed? Or Sister Maggie?
She might have fallen off.
Yes.
Maggie?
Yes, I'm here.
So was that your great-grandmother interviewed on TV at the protest?
That wasn't my great-grandmother. That was S great-grandmother.
Okay, Marlene Branch. Okay, this is Marlene Branch. Okay, so, I mean, the fact that there's people out there, they want to take up the cause, right? But we just got to figure out a way to get everything coordinated, get everything organized. Because Intact Memphis would be a good source of people. It's like they're good people. They mean well. It's like they're really against circumcision of all types. So they'll be a good organization to reach out to. And I believe they're on Facebook. They are on Facebook. So, yeah, this is only a matter of just getting organized. And I'm sure there's other stories out here of people being taken advantage of by this medical system, this medical establishment. Like you alluded to, Brother Sweet, how the laws are made in favor to protect the people who are really doing terrible things to folks that have no protection. They have no say in the law. So hopefully we could change that.
Well, there was a big change back here a few years ago. Remember about all the doctors, we got to protect them from the frivolous lawsuits and all that. Well, you know, nobody, this isn't frivolous. You know what I mean? This is not frivolous.
Mm-hmm.
This should, you know, but we got to jump through the same hoops as anything else because of the laws that passed to protect the doctors and whatever. But, you know, right now, today, we're going to jump through those hoops and try and get Baby Ashton some relief for the future. He has a long life to live, and to the extent that the legal system can provide some relief for him, we're going to get that. And I can promise you that, and I promise Maggie that. That's what we're going to do to the full extent that the legal system can do it. But I think, Ron, that the legal system, the medical system needs to be looked at. You know, that this can happen. And then you can still have to jump through these hoops, and they can hide behind these laws. They can hide behind the HIPAA. They're going to make her pay for her medical records and all those type ridiculous things. You know what I mean? That needs to change.
Mm-hmm. I definitely agree with
that. Not just for her. And maybe Baby Ashton can help bring a light to it and help change it for the future kids to come along, that they don't fall prey to the medical system.
Oh, we hope. We definitely hope. Because it wasn't that long ago. Really, it was recently, like, you know, with the female prisoners out in California, how a lot of them were sterilized against their own will. Or even how states here, like, I believe 21 states in the union, that were sterilizing young women, particularly women of color, against their own wishes. I mean, one favorite famous case, of course, is Fannie Lou Hamer, who the freedom fighter out of Mississippi. She was sterilized by the state. And I know another sister, Elaine Riddick, out of North Carolina, who's currently in Georgia. She was sterilized when she was a teenager. So, I mean, like, you know, a lot of people have been abused by this system. It's a medical apartheid, if you will, this system of white supremacy in the skies of medical care. So we're going to get to the bottom of this. I'm glad that you all are all on the front lines. And I always ask Sister Maggie this. Has this episode questioned, have you questioned your faith in this, during this episode, what's going on with your son? Has your faith been tested by this?
I was nervous. I was scared. I never lost faith in believing in God. through the time that my daughter had to get her heart actually taken out and placed on the table, and they re-hooked up her lungs, and the next day supposed to be my son's surgery, which was going to get reconstructed of his penis. I was kind of afraid of everything that was going on with me and my kids at that time.
So you said the same folks that destroyed his original penis was going to do the reconstruction, correct?
Yes, they was going to they said they was going to correct the problem that happened during circumcision. And when I took him over there to the doctor's office, they stated that they was going to wait until April the 2nd. To do the surgery.
Okay.
And they postponed it because of why, Maggie? Why did they tell you they postponed it?
Because of the lawsuit. And having a lawsuit even been made at that time.
Mm. Oh, my God.
I understand she didn't suit anybody as of yet. Mm-hmm. She didn't suit anybody as of yet. So I guess they knew it was coming. It's so outrageous. You know, they wouldn't anticipate that she would. And here's what Maggie did, just to let you know the kind of person that she is. She went in. I wish you could hear this tape recording. She went in and asked and confronted these people, saying, why wouldn't you tell me about my child's blood loss? How much blood did he lose? Why didn't you give me anything for infection? You know, not only about why'd you do this, but why haven't you told me and sat down with me so I can care for him? They didn't tell her she couldn't care for him. And subsequently, the infection have set up. So she's a strong young lady. She walked back and
confronted me. Sister Maggie, I want to mean to get in your business, but what about the father of baby Ashton? How has he responded to this?
Ashton, when he urinates, he's still in pain as he urinates and won't know about to do x-rays to see. When I took him to the Bonner, I've been taking him back and forth. It's so much that I can do, and I'm still depressing the issue, and I'm just not getting the proper help for Ashton right now. And they're not running x-rays. Checking the urine, they're not doing anything for him.
Wow, okay. But why his father response? Yeah.
I guess due to the fact that the lawsuit has been made in the state of Tennessee.
No, she said how is his father?
Yeah.
Esther's father have not stepped up. He's, I guess, in his own world. He don't want to help any part of
it. I'm sorry to hear that. But so you really are alone. I mean, except for like your family and brother Sweet, your lawyer, you are really in this by yourself for the long haul. And I just want to commend you for being a real mother. I know that you said something that, you know, I'm reading a quote you said in the news, that you said you tried to be the best mom you can be, but it's like the attack of the enemies is always there. I feel like I failed my son. And I don't think you failed your son. I think that you are responding the way a mother will respond when their child is in need. But the system has let you down, you know, and that's the problem. You're doing your end. And what do you mean when you talk about the attack of the enemies? Who are the enemies you're referring to?
Like, you go to doctor's office and you trust these people to take care of your child, or you even trust them with your life, and you know, I feel like they not focusing enough. Half of the doctors out of her stories that they be on drugs, they do all kind of things because of the stunning they have to do to hold a title, and I feel like, you know, the attack of the enemy is always there.
Hey, I'll say that's so true. When you were saying that, I can recall my little baby brother, who's almost 18 now, his last year of high school. When he was born, the doctor actually broke his leg. But then we didn't know the leg was broke. We just know he was crying real loud. He was the loudest baby in the nursery. I mean, he was crying like his lungs was just coming out of his body. kind of found out his leg was broke, and the doctor apologized profusely, but, you know, my mom didn't sue the doctor, but, you know, he was, like, very remorseful for what he did. And people don't understand, a lot of these doctors are just regular people, right? So a lot of them might be alcoholics,
yeah,
they might do drugs.
Yeah, I can relate to what you're saying, because when I was born, the doctor actually pulled me and my mom the wrong way and broke ligaments in my left shoulder. So I can understand where you're coming from on that. And a lot of times, you know, you put all your trust in these doctors and they not living up to that. You know, and my mama did not file a lawsuit. She just let it blew up.
Yeah. But then my aunt, to bring back to what y'all, the road you on currently, my aunt, her second child, because she lost her first child, he was born early, but didn't make it, he was born prematurely. But her second child, you know, was born, and it was like a beautiful child, right? But at the same time, she knew something was wrong, and she kept on telling the doctor something right with my baby. Come to find out that her intestine was not attached correctly. It was loose in her stomach. But had they had acted on when my auntie said there was something wrong with her child, the child would probably be alive today. And she ended up suing them for malpractice. She told them there was something wrong with her child. They kept on saying, no, nothing's wrong. Then the kid ended up dying several days later because he could not get the waste out of his body because his intestines was all twisted up. Her intestines were all twisted up. So she was able to successfully sue and get a settlement. But at the same time, I believe no amount of money could ever replace what they did to your child. I mean, no amount of money
let me give you an example of malpractice. I'm gonna give you one example of malpractice that has gone unchecked and went on for years. Have you seen people who have, like, their hand, they have the use of one arm, the other hand is kind of curled up? You remember, you see people like that?
Yeah.
Okay, you know what that's from, don't you? The majority of his shoulder. Majority of it is shoulder distortion. When they deliver you, they rip the nerves in your arm. You don't see it as prevalent today. You remember how prevalent it used to be? Yeah, it was simple shoulder distortion. And it went on for years. And, you know, nobody ever did much about it. I have a few cases now I'm looking at. But at birth, when they separate the shoulder or pull the shoulder and destroy the nerves. That's a malpractice that went on for years. And there were many kids. It wasn't abnormal to see people walking around at all. You understand? You know what I'm talking about, the condition I'm speaking of. And that was a simple form of malpractice that delivered. That went on in our community for years.
Mm.
Nothing was done about it. Huh? So, yeah, it's been a lot of things that we've suffered through in the medical industry. And hopefully, you know, we get up and people speak out like you're bringing this out, and we try and do something about it and stop it.
All right, we need to know that. People need to know that. Hopefully, we'll get other people the courage to step up with Sister Maggie and not have her by herself on the front line and fighting this. I'm sure that once y'all do the discovery and once people become well acquainted with this case, that more people will come up with, hey, I've been violated too. They did this to my son. They did this to my daughter. Because I just think it's atrocious. That Memphis, here we are, Memphis is known for blues and barbecue and children research. And yet you telling me that she cannot even take her child to Lavana, which is more convenient than driving almost 3 hours to her hometown to get her child seen by a doctor. And that people that call themselves that got the nerve to say Christ, community health, are so un-Christ-like when it comes to take care of little kids and being protective of babies. So I just think this is atrocious. And I just think this is horrible. This cannot go unpunished. This cannot go unrecognized for what it is. It's a crime against humanity. And it's a crime against the poor. But it seems like to me that a lot of times, not just poor people, but it's like black people are used as guinea pigs in this country for white supremacy and for objectives and benefits that we don't get any benefits from. This reminds me of so many things that happen to our people. This is why so many of our people have a problem with the healthcare establishment. We've gone with doctors because they feel like they don't really have our best interest. And when you hear of cases like Baby Ashton and what in the hell that Sister Maggie and her daughter is going through, then you can justify that. We don't have to go back to the Tuskegee experiment. We don't have to look at Henrietta Lacks at Johns Hopkins University where they took her DNA and the medical industry made billions of dollars off her DNA, but her family to this day don't even have adequate health care if they have any type of health care. The descendants of Henrietta lacks our suffering. And we want to change this for Baby Ashton as much as we can. But I just think it is interesting in a system that attacks black manhood from birth that this is a glaring and graphic example of what this system does to try to undermine black men and black manhood. So that's what I'm going to say on that. But y'all have anything else to offer?
No,
I'm glad to share with the audience.
I want to say thank you for having me on, and I'll let Maggie thank you herself. We appreciate you shedding a light on this situation for us, and God be with you, and you keep doing good work. We appreciate you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Maggie?
Sister Maggie?
Thank you for having me on and talking about my son.
And this won't be the last time. Sweet, when you get a chance, email me the information so I can get, because people already, like Brother Christopher out of Fort Hood, the doctor or physician who called in from the Army, he already got $100 waiting to give Sister Maggie, but he just needs the information to give it to her. So, I mean, people are already interested in this case. People talking about it in the chat room, and we'll just get situated.
Well, I'm going to get that stuff tomorrow. I'll probably call you, Ron, to make sure you get it out to everybody, mm-hmm. how they can help donate to her. I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. And our thoughts and our prayers are going out to you and your family, Sister Maggie, and also a brother lawyer, Sweet. Thank you for doing what you're doing for the sister, because we need more brothers like you out there on the front lines as well, representing our people and doing the right thing through the eyes of God.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, goodbye. Goodbye to everybody.
Goodbye.
And thank you all for listening.
Now God bless you all.
All right, thank you.
No problem.